Blood Radio, the music you want.
With your host, D's Dan.
Shall we shag now or shall we shag later?
RadioWhat.com.
What's up, party people? It's Keys Dan with RadioWhat.com, DJLittleRock.com, coming to you live in a living color from the Radio What studios. And this is my podcast, What Makes You Famous. It's an extension of the RadioWhat.com internet radio station that I've been running for quite some time. And if you need DJ services, where do you go? DJLittleRock.com. Check availability and get a free price quote. And maybe you could have me at your next event. Kind of excited about that. All right, today on the program, Shannon Balani. Shay, my man. Now, I've seen this gentleman at several karaoke shows, but I don't know a lot about him. And we're going to get to know more about Shannon Shay Balani in the next few minutes. So you have that to look forward to. This week's shows, due to the COVID-19 coronavirus, I have no public shows, and I have very few private shows, for that matter. So stay tuned for a lot of podcasting in your ears. Stick around. All right, party people, without further ado, let's get into it with Shannon Shay Balani. I'm going to go visit with him at his house, and I'm sure that we'll social distance each other. Oh my goodness, that's got to be the Oxford word of the year. All right, going to Shannon Shay Balani now. Shay Balani.
Yes, sir.
We're on a podcast, man. Wow. Let's go in the kitchen.
Okay.
This looks comfy.
Hello.
Clip one of those to your talking hole, like to your suspenders.
To my talking hole.
Yeah.
There we go.
All right. Give the people a little idea of who you are, Shay Balani. We're on the What Makes You Famous podcast.
Well, I don't know exactly what makes me famous yet. I keep working on trying to improve people's lives by just being there and catching their moment if I can. I am a cartoonist, illustrator, sketch artist. I'm not professionally trained, although I have a semester in art instruction schools, if it even matters. It was the same one that was made famous by Charles Schulz. I noticed that the more time I would sit with people, I would want to get their picture and I would want to draw them, try and capture the eyes and the look on their faces. And I'm really wanting to branch out and, you know, if somebody has something that they would really like to catch in a sketch, something that's not computer generated, something that's a little bit more organic.
Yeah, well, with computers, I can see that paper, putting pen to paper, putting pencil to paper is going the way of the dodo. Hey, you forgot one thing on your list was Life of the Party.
Yes, we are quite the karaoke addict.
Hey, it's not a party till Shay Balani's there, man. Shannon Balani. Just let's break down that name. Growing up with Shannon Balani, because there's all right. I'm imagining kids in the school ground saying different things. I remember growing up. My name's Daniel Gilson. But I went by Daniel Hughes, my stepdad's name, for a little while. And H-U-G-H-E-S. Hey, Huggies. Hey, Huges. Hey, you know, they always break it down. What's the Shannon Balani?
Well, my official name is Shannon Bray Balani with Shay in italics on my birth certificate. I was actually three grandfathers. Shannon is the name of my maternal grandfather. His last name is Shannon. My father's, his stepfather is named Bray. And then Blani, of course, comes from his original dad.
Where's the etymology of Blani?
We are Italian, although a lot of people like to go with Bellane, which is the French sound, and it's awkwardly the spelling, even though we're not exactly certain where the great-grandfather, when he came to America, decided to, how he decided to spell it. We are not sure exactly which we follow back through into Italy.
How many generations can you go back when they came to America from Italy? Because I remember hearing stories of when they went to Ellis Island, and oh my goodness, if you talk about segregation, yes, this is the big melting pot, America. Segregation. Italians did not like the Irish, did not like the, you know, it was like, it was more segregated. Now, you know, there's less segregation, mm-hmm. Maybe three or four different categories that I could think of.
Well, it's kind of awkward that you say that, given the fact that the first name is Irish.
Right.
And then the last name is Italian. But I don't think there was a whole lot of animosity. He was basically poor, needing to find a fresh start, as far as I know. I'm not very versed on my grandfather and my great-grandfather. I know my father grew up in Houston, Texas, and it was rough for him growing up. He was a honky-tonk singer, which was the reason why
I'm... Sounds cool.
I'm more into...
Sounds
karaoke.
Romantic.
I fiddle around with the guitar. I say that because it's nowhere close to actually playing one.
Wait, you fiddle around with a good guitar? Does that mean you use a bow?
No. No, just mess around with it. I don't know. I can chord pretty well. I'm not good picking. My dad tried to teach me, and he had gone and done several of the bar themes back then. So what would have been karaoke back then, I guess, is kind of what I do now. It's like I like to be the life of the party when I'm there.
Well, let me step back a second. I mean, because I've seen you in a lot of karaoke shows. That's the only interaction we've ever had. This is the first time that I'm actually having a conversation in your kitchen, at your house. Mm-hmm. I'm getting to know Shannon Bellani, Shay Bellani, in quotation marks, Shay. Now, that's on the birth certificate. They already knew that they were going to cut Shannon down to Shay, mm-hmm. and that's a name you've had your whole life.
Yes. Well, and it's not really cutting it down as much as it's forming the first two names together.
Shannon and Bray. There you go. And who came up with that idea? Was that mom or dad?
I'm pretty sure it was an equal. I think I couldn't tell you which one was more on board, but I know it was agreed upon.
But, well, okay, so you told me dad's a honky-tonk man from Texas.
Yes.
And traveled around, and that's how he made his living?
No, he didn't. That was just the side gig.
Ah, I gotcha.
He was a furniture upholsterer by trade way back when.
Works with his hands. Uh-huh. That's a job that is necessary. And probably you can find work anywhere if you can work with your hands.
And they actually had a business, him and his family, at that time. And that's how he met my mother.
Is that business still around?
No.
I'm looking for Bellani's furniture, man.
Oh, unfortunately, you know, one other brother had passed on either two or three years ago. Mm. And then... we have one brother left besides my father. Worried about them both at this time of year. You know, this situation, which we will not name.
We can if we want to. This is a time capsule. This is what's going on right now in Shannon Bellani's life. And yeah. You want me to call you Shay or Shannon, or what do you like to go by?
Shay's fun. Between you and me, Shannon is good for anybody who wants to approach me. And I always say, you know, if you're my friend, we're Shay. If, you know, a lot of people know me through business as Shannon. And I like to kind of keep a kind of a distance because there is the play atmosphere
sure.
of who I am. And then there's the technical, all right, let's get busy. We have to do all this work stuff.
As long as the check's cash, you're fine, right? Make them out to Shay, make them out to Shannon.
Well, yeah. And, of course, there's that, too, because, I mean, you know, with layoffs and furloughs, we're all stressed and we're all trying to make it do here.
Yeah, we're living right now, man, in March of 2020. And what is it that you're alluding to? Why are you laid off, man?
It's just that time we weren't essential right now, and hopefully we'll come back. You know, I'm not technically unemployed.
You're gonna make me say it, aren't you?
It's because of the virus. Yes, yeah. It's because without steady customer flow, you can't keep a business. But at the same time, you know, we're gonna make it. It's not in me to give up and throw up my hands and say it's over. We're just going to keep running, and
oh yeah,
and the store will reopen and we'll be fine, which is a whole other deal. I mean, the sketching part right now is so important to me because of two reasons. It's not that I expect a lot of people to be able to pay me. Mm-hmm. This is something that I can do to bring joy back into the narrative.
Yeah, but you're not against getting paid for it, all right?
No,
I don't like the term starving artist. Well, I like the term working artist, you know?
it's a very accurate term, unfortunately.
Yes.
If you're not into computers and if you're not into deep... What's the graphic arts?
Sure.
A lot of this stuff is almost this key to the past kind of thing, and it really shouldn't be, because I mean, there's a lot of emotion and a lot of heart that goes into sitting down and actually looking somebody in the eyes.
Yes.
And sitting there and sketching out their portrait. Now, I haven't done a whole lot, you know, face to face.
Gotcha.
Because people don't like to sit still.
You're talking about you've had some art training, mm-hmm. and the artists of the past had to have that, where they would have people sit. And talking about some of the classic artists that their paintings go for numerous amounts of dollars, some of them did not get their fame. Many of them did not get their fame until after they were dead. You know, I don't want that to happen. I want you to be able to have your art right now and display it and be able to be appreciated for it right now. Because you made a picture of me, and I put it right up right away on social media, made sure that people knew, hey, this was Shay and Bilani. This was Shay that drew this thing, and I'm proud of it. It's gotten a lot of likes, but... it didn't get you any dollars, you know, and I'd like to get you some dollars.
Well, and I appreciate that. And, of course, I did that specifically because I care and I wanted to give you something like I've given so many other people. I've got pictures of all these friends and family that I have and cartoon. I told you I'm trying to rework where I'm selling this book of mine. But I did write a book.
You wrote a book?
Yes.
Well, tell us more about the book.
And it's Teaching an Ostrich to Fly.
What's that about? And what's it under?
It's under Author House Publishing. You can find it sometimes through Amazon. You can find it through Barnes & Noble. I don't get enough on it. They did their part, but they get the better share of the money on that, which is why I'm trying to figure out if I could find another publisher, that would be awesome. And that's kind of
So you went through an actual publisher to get this book done. How long ago was that?
No, I self-published.
Okay.
Is what I did. And a lot of times since then I've been told, you know, that's one of the things that will get you in trouble is that, but I honestly believe that putting it out there would do something, and then it just kind of fell like a rock. But I believe in it. I believe that its story still could capture today. It's a kid's book, though.
You know? Yeah.
And the whole idea is this family of bluebirds. And in the first book, it's just the mother trying to teach her adopted ostrich son how to fly. And I've got all my pictures in there, and just the way I like them. I mean, just it's really kind of whimsical. And the whole idea is every time she tries to get this ostrich to fly, the ostrich will run, it'll flap its wings, and it'll crash.
Did we get an idea? When was this?
This was, it was actually a concept all the way back in 2000. I didn't get it published until I think 2003, 2004.
Did you have kids at that time?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. The oldest is, you know, back from 96.
So what ostrich were you teaching to fly? Was this something that came from your personal...
Well, actually, and my brother, Kip Stringer, he was the inspiration because Kip is from Seoul, Korea. And
your brother's from Seoul, Korea.
He's from Seoul, Korea. He was adopted, just like I'm adopted.
What?
From my mother and father. He was adopted, and my mother was married to another gentleman at that time, and they adopted him, and it was like raising him in the South in the 60s and 70s. And there's obvious differences.
Mm-hmm.
Just like with an ostrich to a bluebird, there's obvious differences. But the book ends with the notion that ostrich can run faster than that bluebird can fly. And there is something to be said there, which is we all have importance, we all have meaning, we all have... Deep down, we are special, being who we are. And it doesn't make us any different. The special nature about us all, we're all together. We're all one.
That is fantastic, man. And that come around in 2000 in your mind to write for your brother. That's fantastic. Well, tell me about him growing up in the South. Yes, there are obvious differences. And in that particular time, there was... I mean, still turmoil, racial turmoil.
Oh, yeah.
You know, blacks, whites, Asians, and when you have those obvious differences, it's got to be tough. I'm glad he had you to guide him along.
Well, no, it's the other way around. He's the older brother.
He is.
Yeah, he's got...
How much older?
12 years on me.
Okay.
And state police officer.
Yeah.
In
Texas?
No, here in Arkansas.
Oh, Arkansas, okay.
Arkansas. And just one of the finest gentlemen you'll ever meet. He really is. I do look up to him. I can tell you, we've been brothers, so we've had our moments. But
yeah, but you came around. He was 12. He's almost a man in some laws. You know, religious laws, almost a man.
Oh, yeah.
And, well, how did you, I guess you had little fights, or you look up to him, and you wanted to be like him, I'm guessing?
We had our fights. I did look up to him. He actually can play the guitar.
Cool.
Amazingly well. He introduced me to Alabama, was the first real band. And I listened to it until, I mean, it was the only thing I knew through the first part up until my teens. I did listen to a few of his other bands. He was into Kiss at one time.
Well, that's diverse.
Yeah, and I think the only other two things that I listened to early on was Ray Stevens and Lee Greenwood. And I would listen to him and his bunch of friends play. They would get together and grab their guitars, and they would have sing-arounds at the house.
Excellent.
So,
excellent. And the rest of the school gathered around, or the block at least? Or
I think this was just, you know, a handful of friends. Yeah. It wasn't, you know, I would love to say that the school would crowd, but I don't think the school crowded around any of us. So,
yeah, well, you got a diverse family, and people look at it, sometimes they look at it in fear when you're different, you know? Wow, that's different. It's not the same as me. His face looks different. His skin looks different. You know, so you had to deal with that kind of thing, having it in your family.
Well, I don't know. I mean, no? I would like to think, and some other people have changed my opinion over the years, but I still would like to think that where I was growing up back in Van Buren County, Clinton, Arkansas area, the people were genuinely open and receptive. But I, you know, that's the difference in looking back. You see things through an 8-year-old mind or a 10-year-old mind, and now I'm 44 going, I don't know if that was the way it was, or if that was just my romantic impression of what the past used to be. But I hope he felt accepted. He sure seems accepted now.
Yeah, guitar playing cop. I love it. That's fantastic. You got that in your family. Mm-hmm. You got guitar playing upholstery. That's dad. Tell me about your mama.
Well, my mom was a teacher. She taught in Texas, and she taught in Arkansas. She taught special education for 27 years before she retired. Actually started the special education program in Clinton. And I'm probably going to get this wrong. I think she also started it in Cabot.
Your mama did that?
I think.
Special education?
Special education. Because special education...
And this is way long ago.
Yeah. Yeah. My mom's in her late 70s. She gave most of her time to teaching children. And then...
Why did she start the special needs one?
Well, I don't quite know...
Yeah.
The ins and the outs. It seemed like they needed somebody to do it, and she was the only one that had any kind of background at the time. And I don't know about... I'm not even certain about the Cabot. I'll have to go back and ask her about that one. But in Clinton, C.G. Cowsard wanted her to do it.
Mom's still around?
Oh, yeah.
That's fantastic.
Dad's still around. He's 83, 84.
Wow. Yeah. And what are they doing respectively?
Staying inside.
I got you.
Yeah, especially right now.
But they're still together?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay. It was mom had a original, had one marriage, and then married your dad.
Yes.
Okay. All right. I'm getting the timeline down. Sorry, loyal listeners. It's me in my head. All right, Shay, and they're still living. And where are they living at? What city?
They're in Clinton.
Clinton. Yeah. Man.
I'm an hour away. And, you know, social distancing aside, I go make the drive and do their shopping for them if they need it. I prefer them to stay in right now.
Yeah, I mean, let me lay it out. I mean, it's March 2020. We have the COVID virus out there. People are... Hopefully, when history gets written, we're overdoing it, over protecting each other. Even me and Shay, as we're speaking, we're probably about 6 feet apart from each other. You know, we're the only two in this building, so the gathering is small. Mm-hmm. You know, and we didn't fist bump, we didn't handshake, we didn't hug like we usually do. So, yeah, social distancing. It's kind of weird. I hope they're over precautious. And, you know, I was washing hands before it was trending.
I had food service for 8 years, so I know about washing hands.
Worked in food service.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay. All right. And we're protecting our older folks, the people that might be more susceptible. Not that all old folks are sick. When I worked in a hospital, I thought all old people must be sick. No, they're not. Old people can go out and be very productive, way up into their 80s and 90s. I have a 91-year-old grandma that just celebrated her birthday Friday, and she still drives and out and about. And I love it. But protect your families.
Oh, yeah.
Shay, and you're protecting your family, man. You got to... man, that's incredible that your mom started a special needs. And what... I mean, being a teacher for the first thing is amazing. It's a great responsibility. You know, what led her to an even greater responsibility of caring for people with special needs? I really, man, I'd love to know more about your mom. And you know, well, we know your dad. He's the upholstering honky-tonk man.
Yeah, he was. He was also... Deputy Sheriff of Van Buren County.
What?
When I came into the picture, and that's what I remember him doing. So,
okay, so by the time you were born, he was a cop.
Yeah.
Okay, and I guess that inspired your brother.
Yes.
How many brothers and sisters you have? So they were into adopting.
No,
how many biological?
It depends on how you look at it.
Right.
There's me and my brother.
Yes.
My mother had a stillborn child that they named Wendy. So she is my sister. We had one foster sister, Elizabeth Hightower. I remember her. I went back and I found... I've actually been face to face with one of my birth sisters
that you lost track of for a while and then came
back
to.
Well, I mean, there was some fun stuff about that. Her name is Misty Wright. She still lives in Texas. And I didn't know that my dad knew. And I said I would really like to meet you know somebody, and he said, well, I know that her name, and my dad told me. And come to find out, my uncle and aunt owned a child care place in Houston, and sometime when I was young, I don't know exactly the year or how old I was, but they actually sat her side by side with me to see how much we looked alike. And I did not know. And I did not know that until, you know, I was an adult. And when they finally told me, I said, well, I need to call this person up. And I searched and I found her. And I have three sisters on that side. But I've only been able to meet her and her father and her mother now, I've met them. So I have that. I have no idea who the birth father is. So I sometimes I think, you know, I might do one of those 23andMe's just to see what all filters through.
Yeah.
And I may do so after... you know, the finances all work themselves out. But, you know.
Man, that's That's an amazing family tree. I mean, you said that you can't get past your grandfather. I'm pretty much the same. I think I have roots like a radish. Mm-hmm. You know, some people have roots like an oak tree. They can recite their name like the Bible. You know, just, you know, years, many generations past. But you know, you're living right here. And it sounds like your mom and dad taught you a lot about taking care of people. You know, fostering, adopting, that's a certain type of person that can do that. Mm-hmm. Even they had their own biological children, right?
My mom never could carry to term.
That was Wendy. Okay.
Yeah, Wendy was the only one that made it close enough.
Okay.
And yeah, her only option was to adopt.
And that's still noble, though. Still and bringing people together and taking care of kids that are out there
and
need to care.
As she would put it, it's not like having somebody else's child either. That's your child.
Yes. She's,
there is no distinction, and there isn't. I recognize that this other lady gave birth to me, but she's my mom, but she's not my mom.
Right.
My mom is my mom.
Yes, she is.
There's no way that anybody could take where I've been, where I've been raised.
You feel like you were treated real nice? Everybody pretty much had a fair shake in the fam?
Yeah, I do. I think, I don't know. You know, if Kip would agree, but, you know, I think
Who's the favorite? Who's the favorite?
I'm probably the favorite.
Oh, that's
probably
sweet.
The favorite.
my little brother's, I think that's my mom's favorite. Now, my grandma, I'm her favorite. So, and if they listen to this, which they will, they'll know. I know. I know.
I don't know if Kip will hear this one or not. I hope he does. I respect him. But I do. I think he would even agree that I was the youngest, so the youngest usually gets the.
So you've already alluded. You keep in touch with your mom and dad. You keep in touch with the rest of the fam. You keep in touch with Kip.
I'm not good at it. I try to. I probably should call, but you know.
Well, good. I hope you will after this podcast is over. I mean, you know, the phone goes both ways. And a lot of times, my grandma, I try to get a call her at least once a week. Mm-hmm. But if she needs anything, she can call me. And my mom, too. You know, I try to call her from time to time. But, you know, the phone goes both ways. Yeah. My little brother, he's all the way in North Carolina. We need to talk more. Mm-hmm. Hey, you're getting me the feels on families and stuff and keeping in touch with families. Mm-hmm. Man, you've gone through some hardships, man. Your mom was a teacher, and do you have an affinity for teachers? It seems like you like teachers, and in that in particular, special needs teachers.
Well, and yeah, I mean, the ex, of course, Scarlett, she came into the family. I don't think she was looking to be a teacher at the time. I think she was, I don't know how she feels now. That's a whole other sad little story, but, you know.
But it's still part of you, Shay.
Yeah, it is.
You know, how'd you meet? And, you know, I know that things have gone south, spoiler alert. You know,
well, and you know, I'm back out there. I don't really know if it has anything to do with teaching, but you know, the fact that she picked up and rolled with it, I am gonna continue to always say that I am proud of what Scarlett had done. Mm-hmm. With her adult life when it came to that career choice, especially after one of our daughters came back with dyslexia. She dove right in and found things that we weren't even using at the time in Clinton.
Well, brag on the kids. What's going on with them?
Glory continues to work in a pharmacy. She's not a tech or anything. She just, you know, cashes people out. But that's a good thing right now.
Productive member of society. Sounds good to me.
Mm-hmm. Victoria is a junior this year at school, which they're going to finish out now, it looks like, online.
Okay.
And she'll be a senior next year. And I hope by that time we're well beyond this. Stone, of course, is Stone, which is goes back to why I'm still proud of Scarlett's decisions. He, of course, is moderately autistic. Mm-hmm. He'll probably be needing us to take care of him the rest of his life. After the divorce, I moved down here because I'm anticipating that he will probably move into a long-term care facility here in Conway, so I can be where I need to be, which kind of influences the dating realm a little bit, because everybody I talk to, so you know, just so you know, if this works out, you're gonna have to move here.
Yeah, but that's a good daddy. Yeah, that moved the close, you know, and already anticipated. Hey, I'm gonna have to take care of my son. That's my boy. And that's what we do for the rest of their lives in whatever capacity. Yours might be a little more strenuous, that you have to really pay much focus. Mm-hmm. But there are facilities that can help you out, and you already anticipated that as well.
Mm-hmm. I'm hoping.
You have something in mind, I guess, down the way?
Not really. We've just gone through others and know that they've already closed their doors, and this is the most likely chance in Conway. So it's a work in progress. We'll figure that one out as we go. But he's a good boy. Sometimes he's destructive and willfully and very gleefully. Which makes it hard on a sketch artist, because the most favorite thing he likes to do is rip paper. I mean, he loves the sound, loves the feel, which is very akin to those autistic needs. You almost can't blame him for it.
Yeah,
he needs that stimulation. He just does.
So he's ripped up a few sketches then.
Yeah,
that's what you're alluding to.
Well, and I've gotten to where I hide things where no one would think to look.
Yeah, no, I'm not telling you. I'm not telling the people where you pointed.
Just up high and out of the way, and yeah, usually outside of little eyes. Seeing.
Where did you grow up?
Now, I grew up in Clinton.
Clinton.
I grew up in Clinton. I've been in Arkansas most of my life. I spent the first week in Texas. I found that I needed to move.
So you were born in Texas?
I was born in Houston, Texas.
How about that? And then moved and quickly shuffled off to your new family and in Clinton, Arkansas.
Yeah.
And how is it growing up in Clinton? That's a smaller town.
I love Clinton. I actually said that I was never going to leave. And, well, necessity requires change.
Yeah, that's circumstance. I mean, yeah. For the most part, you didn't leave. You're here, you made it all the way to 40. I wasn't going to leave Miami, and I left at 40, you know, just to... Some things happen, you know. Sometimes you need a change in life.
I've got, so many great friends there. One that we share in particular, Dale James, is now the county judge there. So, I mean...
That's a cool dude right
there. You know, you grow up and you see this guy who's been an influence in your teenage years, and now he's...
You've known him your whole life?
Oh, I've known him for 30 plus years.
Come on. Clinton, small town.
Small town.
How many great relationships? I mean, how many friendships, long-lasting friendships, have you built from Clinton?
I've got, David Puckett. A lot of people aren't going to recognize that name, but he does a lot of building in Little Rock and Conway area. He still lives in Choctaw outside of Clinton. Kevin Allen is a good friend of mine.
That's what you do in a small town. Build those long-lasting relationships. You know, most people, if you have one friend that lasts more than 20 years, mm-hmm. that's a lot. But in a small town, mm-hmm. people know people. Everybody knows everybody, which is good and bad. I guess you have everybody's in your business, but they're going to help you out if you're in trouble.
Oh, yeah.
For the most part.
In fact, Ryan Stripling, who you know as... He'll come and sing sometimes. Mm-hmm. He checks on my family. He lives right down the road from them. Good man. Good man.
Yeah, even though you're not with the ex, you still have to keep responsibility. You have kids.
Oh yeah.
And so are you kind of amicable now at least?
I no.
All right. From an outsider's perspective, when you both showed up at the RAB, I was like, how's this going to go?
Well, if you recall, she sat over there and I sat over.
All right.
And it's not that we're fighting, because we're not.
Right.
But, I'm not going to drag her through.
No, hopefully and that fighting ends with divorce, man.
Hopefully,
that's it.
Hopefully she never feels the need to drag me through. But, you know, you have hurt feelings.
Yes.
And when you do, sometimes it's better to just walk away.
Yes. I could see hurt feelings, man. You were trying to build a life together, and, you know, hey, that fell apart. But you got the kids, and that's great, man.
Yeah.
You know, it sounds like the three of them are doing fine. You mm-hmm. know, one might need a little more help, but, Gloria and Victoria... sounds like they're heading in the right direction, man. And Master Stone, I love that boy. When he comes out and sings, you could tell he has a passion for singing. Oh my goodness!
Sometimes he gets the words right.
So, you got it. And he'll he'll sing that Crazy Train and just Sweet Irony, but just I love it. I love it. When your whole family comes out to karaoke, I feel the joy in my heart, and I know you have a passion for it, and I'm sad that you're not all going to be together, but seeing you as individuals is a good thing, too. Shay, oh, man, we're going through your life. So it brings you what interest did you have when you were in school? I mean, how was Clinton as a school system growing up?
I liked it. I don't know. I don't think I could have gotten a better education. I really don't. Because a lot of it was up to me to decide. And a lot of my troubles were not really wanting to follow through the first few teenage years of my life. By the time I got to 18, I really... felt like I did a real good job in my senior year. I mean, there's no way I would ever have been valedictorian or salutatorian, but I was happy. I had finished advanced biology, and I thought, wow, and I got a B the last semester. I was like, that proves at least I could retain the knowledge. The rest of the time was just me not really putting forth the effort at the time. And that, not to say that I didn't have tons of people, my mother, my grandmother, pushing me, teachers as they were, so you got to focus, and I just didn't have it in me. And those first few front line teenage years were rebellious.
Well, I'm feeling that, smaller town, smaller school size, smaller classrooms, is that what it was, or was it still jam-packed with kids?
It wasn't, but we were, I was bullied. And
why were you bullied, man?
I was the nerd. What? I was the nerd, I was the geek.
What were you into? What made you different that people wanted to bully you, pick you out of the lineup?
I was smart, but I wasn't smart enough to be officially a nerd. I was banned. I loved the band. I mean, just solid.
What'd you play?
I was percussion.
Percussion. Well, I think every kid with a desk is percussion. All the boys beat on their desk. So, well, percussion in a band is playing the big drum or little snares or.
I played cymbals. I've played tritom. I've played snare drum. I've played bass drum. I've played auxiliary, which is every little piece throughout triangle.
Marching band too.
Cowbell. More cowbell.
Yes.
Fever for more cowbell.
I knew that was coming.
Marching band.
Marching band. Wore the little suits. You dressed like a toy soldier.
We look like mustard toy soldiers. I mean,
school colors?
It was golden black.
Golden black. Okay, yeah. I think my was black and gold at Western High School in Davie.
Those suits were far from gold. Those suits back then, they've got better suits now.
So it was primarily gold with black piping?
It was, well, they had the white flue and
yes.
The black helmet that looked like it looked like a box on the top of your head.
Right.
And they had this thing where you would put on the pants first, and then you would put over this coat and have to zip it up and then button it. And it was so hot.
I believe it.
And there was never a time. I recall now that the kids get to wear sometimes their T-shirts and pants. I'm like, I would have killed to have gotten to wear a T-shirt.
During practice you had to wear
And during the summertime, the first part of the marching season, you'd be sitting there like, I'm going to die.
Yeah, but you're saying these kids today can get out in their T-shirts and go march?
Sometimes.
What? No.
I've seen them do it.
That's not right. No, that's one of the whole points of being in a band is getting in that toy soldier uniform and going and doing your thing.
And I think their uniforms are quite a bit more comfortable than ours were back then. I mean, I had a thing that you had to even clip under your neck. The top of that uniform would come all the way around. It's not like you could move your head side to side. Yeah.
Sounds like you're in a neck brace.
And then theirs are like V-neck with the sash and things going on. And I'm like, that looks comfortable. Why couldn't we have had that back in the day? That would have been, I would have gladly worn that.
These kids today don't know how good they have it.
Exactly.
So marching band, that was your extracurricular throughout, or being in band was your extracurricular throughout high school. When did you start that? 9th, 10th grade?
Oh, no. I started it way back in 7th. Back
Wow.
When, you know, back when we were a different band entirely, they didn't have a junior and senior band. They just had band.
Oh, okay, so all the kids in this small town would go to one class.
From 7th grade through high school, all the way to senior, we were all the band. So,
that is cool.
Yeah.
And how's the summer spent? Band camp?
No, actually, I didn't know much about band camp until when I got into high school. We did have practices after school. We would do that, but we would practice in our hour during school, and then the after hours band. I do remember going to UCA for one band camp. I think I might have gone twice.
Yeah.
That's been a lifetime ago.
Hey, it's not that long ago. We're not too old for this. I'm 51, so I've eaten about 11 more years. Or 10, what you say? You're 40.
I'm 44.
Yeah. Eh, st- still kind of contemporary. We know the same music. You started with country music, Alabama, and of course everyone had to be in the Kiss Army back then. So yeah, there's a reason that your brother got into Kiss. They were everywhere, man. Those guys could market, baby. They could market.
Mm-hmm.
Shay, my man, hanging out in your kitchen in Conway, Arkansas. And, man, I'm learning so much more about you. And man, everybody's got a story. You got a story, man. So tell me more. I mean, those band the whole reason for living in school? Or was there more extracurricular? What made you a nerd?
Well, I'll tell you and give you a little bit more history as far as the music career goes. You know about my dad now. You know, my mom really wasn't all that musical, but my grandmother, when she was young, would teach violin and piano. And she actually played for a master, a pianist. Actually also went to the Carnegie, she took the courses actually in New York. She was an amazing person on her own. I wish I could give her history justice, but she influenced musically who I am.
Right.
She would type up everything. She never applied for a job in her life, but people would come to her knowing what her skill set was and would ask her if she would come on board, and she worked for banks, and she worked at payroll, and she would type up documents. In fact, I have her typewriter sitting over there, and it's a...
Oh, man, that is an ancient typewriter.
Underwood. It's total steel. I mean, it's so heavy.
Who did I hear collects type? Oh, Tom Hanks. I think he collects typewriters. Quote me on that.
I don't know if he does or not. He might would have wanted that one. That one came out of the New Yorker, that publishing area in New York before the building burned down.
What?
That's what my grandmother told me. I don't know if I...
So while she was learning music up there, she was doing Joe jobs, typing for people, typing things up. I mean, that was an important job that a woman could get back in the day. Mm-hmm. It was being a secretary of sorts. And if, you know, I think I've heard a lot of older folks say that typing was a necessity for ladies, because that was a job you can get. Either you'd be a waitress or a typist, and typists seem to be the better of the two gigs.
Mm-hmm.
You know, thankfully, women get more opportunities now. I mean, that's just revisionist history, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
There must have been other things they could do. Housewife, I guess, was the other alternative.
I credit her, though, from the main part of my personality.
Yes.
Because she was very... she had her opinion about things, but her opinion never overshadowed her desire to help people and want to be there and caring deeply. And that I don't know if hers came from the winning friends and influencing people from the Dale Carnegie course, but I know that she had those books and was fond in telling the memories about that.
Oh, but and you got to see the books and delve into them,
and I still have them somewhere.
Wow,
they're up in storage somewhere. But things that I don't, once again, let down where little hands can play.
Good daddy.
But I have this. I'm almost sorry I didn't pursue a career in music, but I had this wonderful background in music, but this art thing it called to me.
Well, I mean, at 18, when you got out of high school, what did you want to be when you grew up?
I wanted to be a father and a great husband.
Okay.
And I felt like I was.
And had you met your ex by then?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. We were childhood.
High school.
High school.
I didn't know that part.
And yeah, I'm sorry she felt the need to move on, but that's her.
Yes. I know there's hurt feelings there, but
yeah, I'm.
We will prevail. We will move on.
Well, that's what you got to do. You, yeah. For a while, you start to say, well, that's it. Let's take the curtain call and forget it. And,
right.
And then sometimes you look at yourself in the mirror and say, know what? I'm not going to let anybody win. I'm going to fight back, and I'm going to be better than I was before. And you need some of that tenacity to live.
Yes.
Survival requires there to be a push. And
well, you got a nice place to live in Conway. This is great, man.
Yeah,
I like it.
It's
clean.
Not the it. Well, I take care of it.
Yeah.
I do that. I when you consider what that boy can take apart.
Yeah.
It'd take you a good day to recoup from him, but I love him to death. I do.
It's a challenge.
I'm never as happy, no matter how crazy the house gets. I'm never as happy as I am when I have my children in the house.
Well, mission accomplished. When you were 18, you wanted to be a father.
Yeah.
And there you are, man. You're a good daddy. Mm-hmm. I could see it. And anybody that knows you can see it. You know, that you care for your kids.
Mm-hmm.
And you care for your family, man. Mm-hmm. And love will come again.
This
man's got a voice of an angel.
I hope it will. I hope it will. I hope I find somebody that will be happy to go and sing with.
Yes.
That's
what you're looking for.
I'm looking for somebody who would enjoy the company of somebody who is off kilter and is playfully and cute and crazy.
I like that.
Because, I'm not an in-the-box kind of person. My family is not the in the norm. We're great people, but we're not. Some of us hunt, some of us fish. I don't do either. and in the South, I get looked at. I'm like, I'm sorry. I don't particularly care.
So besides getting on various podcasts and putting yourself out there to the world, how have you delved back into the dating at 44 years old, man?
It's crazy. I know I wasn't good at it when I was a teenager. I am horrible as it in 44. I've had one really good girlfriend. And we ended on good terms, and we still talk, and I think that's awesome.
Good. Good. I mean, you know, it's hard to get back into it, especially you haven't had to date. You had one steady girl until you were in your 40s, you know? So, yeah, it's kind of tough getting back into it. I couldn't imagine, you know, I don't know. I don't date. I don't date. You know, I couldn't.
Well, I would like to not to, but yeah. I think that's part of life. Is you know, I've grandly wrecked this. I don't say that. Shouldn't say that I wrecked it. It wasn't my choice. But this motorcycle has wrecked, and I don't ride motorcycles, by the way. But I've got to get back on the cycle, and I got to keep driving. There's no.
Did you get on dating sites at all, or
oh yeah?
How are you trying to meet the ladies?
I try to talk to people. I get more catfished, And when you get catfished, then you don't know whether you're talking to somebody real or not. And right. So I'm sure there's probably some ladies out there that are thinking, he's a jerk. He was talking to me and then he just quit talking. And I'm like,
well, there's robots out there.
I don't know if you're real.
These AIs are crazy. You know, I get on Instagram especially, I get hello and I go hi, hi, hello, hello, hi. Hi, you know, where are you from? Look at my profile.
Yeah.
You can see where I'm from.
And I get upset with the ones that they'll say in their profile, they'll say, I'm from Little Rock, or I'm from Conway, or I'm from Clinton. And I especially if it's Clinton, I'm like, I don't recall you at all. We were, you know, I think I would have passed by you at Walmart at some point. But then you find out, I'm in Minnesota, or I'm in, I had one that ended up being all the way across the seas, and I'm like, listen, don't waste my time. Right. If you're not in the backyard and can meet me for coffee, and now we're dealing with the social distancing atmosphere of it, which actually is a good thing. I mean, it's actually driving more people to go to those resources, and you can actually sit down and have an honest conversation with somebody for once, instead of it being send me a card, send me an Amazon card or a Walmart. I had this one I talked to for 3 days. And on the third day, she said, well, I'm having trouble. Can you help me pay my bills? No.
Right.
No.
Right.
You don't ask somebody that you just met, oh, well, I thought we were a couple. No.
Right.
Not until you sit down and have a meal with me, or at least we both agreed that that's what we've come to. And I don't know how I fit in, because there's some that say they don't want to be serial dating, and I'm sitting here going, I want to know that I want to continue dating you before I decide whether I'm done talking to everybody else.
Right. No, man, it's hard to get out there. It's hard to, in this time, well, when online dating. And I know I've had some success stories. I've heard of them where people have swiped right on each other and have come up with, hey, we're getting married. That's how we met. I get to go to weddings all the time. And some of those wedding stories are now becoming the norm. It used to be, oh, we met online. Ooh, no way. You met online. What a creeper. No, you met online is a thing now.
Sounds like a good thing. In fact, since you bring up the weddings, man, I'm hoping somewhere down the line somebody in those weddings hears about my sketching, so I can do some of these wedding photos so they can have something that they can treasure along with their photos.
We'll bring it right back around to the art.
Bring it right back to the art.
I like that.
I have to take my moments when they come.
No, absolutely, man. We're here primarily to talk about what you're doing to pass the time away while your day job is out of commission. You have another avenue, a creative avenue. You can draw, man, and draw faces. That is, to me, it's incredibly difficult. And I think hands, I think, is generally what people cannot do.
I hate the hands.
Hands?
I have to really slow down.
Right.
I have a couple of really good artist friends, and I don't know if they'd want me to plug their names.
Oh, you better shout them out. Well, I want to get some help for everybody.
Well, I mean, there's Barry Branscombe, and
Where's he out of?
I don't know if he's still in Clinton or if he's in Conway, but he used to, I think he still has a business called Master's Touch, and he's a really good guy. And if you're looking for signs or something graphic art related, he is a really good guy to call in state. And I'd like to shout out to him, because the one thing I wanted them to know is that I'm not stepping on their toes.
Right.
This is all something different.
Dude, there's room for everybody.
Bill Green is another one. Yes. And Bill Green was a couple of years younger than me. I graduated in Clinton, Arkansas, I do believe. He has made a massive career in the graphics arts. He is actually one of the creators of Unreal Tournament. And
what is that?
I think he works, I'm not certain, but I think he works on Fortnite as one of the others that he has done.
What's Unreal Tournament?
Unreal Tournament was, I think, about 10 or 15 years ago. It was a one-on-one, I can't remember if it's a shooting game or if it's a fighting game.
That's
but
cool.
But I know that his career has been in the graphics arts, and we had a little bit of a rivalry back when in school, and I'll go online right now to say that he was the better artist.
Competition is good for both of us, good for everybody, and you know, it makes you better people.
Yeah, I'm not here to overshadow him. He's great at what he does, and I'm just now saying, you know, it's time for me to do something that's beneficial, something that makes people happy. And until I can get back to the karaoke soon, I've got tons of time, and hopefully I can weather this storm.
Yeah, you're a man that lives alone primarily. Mm-hmm. I mean, how are you living? Are you still getting a check somewhere?
Not right now.
Uh-huh.
Not right now. We were furloughed. Hopefully, once again, I'll go back to work. If not, I'm going to start looking eventually for another job if this doesn't pan out.
Yeah, as we speak, 3.3 million people have applied for unemployment.
And I'm fixing to be one of them. Yeah. I haven't done it yet.
Probably should have, at least for partial benefits, something.
Well, it becomes a part of the date. We're not officially furloughed until today, actually. Huh. Today is the first day.
Happy anniversary or whatever. Mazel tov.
So I'll have to start looking. I'll probably start looking tomorrow and pushing and seeing what I can do, because survival is essential at this point. And it's survival with the intent of going back. It's not, you know.
Right. People had steady jobs.
Oh, yeah.
You know, but they're not working those jobs. And there's a lot of jobs that you could do from home. Mm-hmm. I'm seeing that some of these jobs, like office jobs, can be done from home, and you'll be more productive at home if you can do it. Mm-hmm. But the job you have during the day, you can't do it from home. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like a retail job, right?
Oh yeah. Retail. Yeah. And it all depends on what kind of retail. Because if you were a member of Walmart or Target or something like that, you still have one. You still can because they're still crowding your doors trying to get toilet paper and eggs and whatever else. And you know, the one thing that I realize in this moment, and if it could ever be recorded for historical significance, is that we're in this together. Oh, yeah. I realize there's some people that have to go to work, and they're worried about what they bring home, and I'm with you. I totally get that. And then there's those of us that really want nothing but to work, but realize, number one, starting over from scratch and right now finding a job is near impossible. And we're just all here for one another. And if anything I can do, like this sketching thing, brings somebody some happiness.
Well, a lot of the singers are singing online, you know, putting a camera up. And
I didn't know about that till last night.
Yeah.
Dale actually brought that up.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, you know, maybe I need to
get your phone, make a little video.
Yeah, sing her out in front of the computer or whatever.
Get your Jones. I'm hurting. I need some karaoke.
Yeah, well, I mean, this was therapy. I wish I could have come more times to see you, but I, you know, finding this little place in Little Rock at Khalil's Pub.
Oh,
the people there were real nice. It's where I've done the majority of my sketches because it was something that I could do that would make people happy.
So between singing, you're so sketching?
I'm sketching.
That's fantastic.
While I'm singing. And I've gotten to where that's what I do primarily, is that I just sketch different things. Although I wasn't officially employed, I worked with a newspaper back in Clinton called The Voice, and put little cartoon snippets of what I called our Van Buren County family album. So I've got these little cartoon snippets that I'm a big Far Side fan.
Excellent, man.
So I want to be able to tell a story in one frame.
Yes. Family circus, man. That's
frame.
Now, talking to Khalil's, man, you could see if they'll display some of your art. That would be cool. Because I know I talked to a photographer over at Nexus Coffee down in Little Rock, and they display his photographs up on the walls, which gives their customers something to look at while displaying his photographs. So I could see that as an artist, you go into one of these, maybe a mom and pop store, a coffee shop, Khalil's pub, maybe, and saying, hey, I got these sketches. And maybe put a little frame on it and pop it up on the wall and throw a little price on the bottom and see if anybody bites.
Uh-huh. I was actually hoping to have this one lucrative moment, and this has been a couple of months ago. I was sitting with my pad and I was drawing somebody, and this guy comes up out of nowhere and he looks at me and he says, will you draw me a picture? And I said, of what? And he said, it doesn't matter, you draw me a picture and I'll give you $100.
Okay, in my head, when you started that story, I'm thinking of Rose on the Titanic, draw me like one of your French girls.
Yeah, no.
I'm glad it went a different way.
No, I didn't. He initially he said, draw me, and I said, you want me to draw you? And then he goes, no, and he grabs one of the waitresses, and he says, you draw her. And I said, well, then I have to have her permission. That's always been my big thing, is before I do... some of the sketches I do for private that will never see the light of day, that's one thing. But if I'm doing something and it's going to be out and I'm going to get paid for it or something, I have to have their permission.
Is that something internal? Because it seems like if they're out in the public, you could take their picture.
Well, yeah, it's just that I want to be... polite about it.
You're
I think
good dude.
I think you it's just nice, and she was more than willing, and I took her picture, and basically he said I need it in 30 minutes.
What?
And I said okay, and I started going as fast as I could, and it went from $100. No, I give you $50, and I'm like, whatever, because I'm in. So I'm expecting $50 or $100, and I get right towards the 20-minute mark, and he sees this picture coming together, and he says, "I don't think it looks like her." And she's standing right there. Says, "It looks exactly like me," and he gets up and he leaves. So, and the thing about it was...
So he commissioned the art. He did not pay for the art.
I ended up giving her and she said, "Do you want me to pay you?" I said, no, I don't want you to pay me. I would have drawn it anyway if I had the chance. I said, it wasn't about the money at the time. It was about somebody telling me, can you do it in 30 minutes?
Yeah. Challenge accepted.
And I said, you're on. I guarantee you, I'll take that bet. And
you're not, and just so people know, you're not doing caricatures. You're doing like still lifes, like real pictures.
I can do caricatures. I like them.
Oh, okay.
And the thing is that, you know, that's part of the cartooning aspect.
Yes.
Sometimes you want a cartoon, and sometimes I choose to do something that's kind of anime.
Okay.
And then I like the realism. But the realism is something you can either have a color page, which is me drawing the outlines and not really doing a whole lot of the shading, and so you don't get a whole lot of the depth, and that takes 15 minutes.
Yes.
But it's like the one I did on you that's online. I think I sat down and did it for 3 hours.
Thank you for taking that time, man. I had no idea. And I figured the realist would take more brain power, more skill. And you, man, thank you. 3 hours.
3 hours, yes. And I was sitting at my mom and dad's house doing it because we had just closed the store, which was not this last Tuesday, but Tuesday before that.
Yeah.
So this has all been real quick.
All those sketches on the table, and there must be 20 of them.
Oh, those sketches that I have on the table and the ones that I have on the hard drive on the computer are over the last 3 years.
Okay. Now, are you doing stuff on the computer, or is it all pen to paper?
It's all pencil to paper.
Pencil
to paper. And sometimes I use color, but I don't prefer the color. And it's all in basic pencil. It's not, I know a lot of people have several different pencils that they do different lines on. I just don't press down as hard.
What kind of pencil?
It's basic 7 millimeter lead in the...
Not a number 2 pencil, a mechanical pencil.
I can use a number 2. I like the number 2, but the number 7 is better. Controllable for fine lines.
Have you done artwork on a computer?
I have the majority of the well,
are you open to it?
I'm open to it, but I'm not a graphic artist.
Gotcha.
I don't have the background and I don't have the study. I think about taking it up sometimes, but there's so many people that can do that.
Yes.
And once again, it loses something to
yeah,
me.
The texture, but the advantage, is grabbing a computer. I guess they have these laptops or these tablets that are under $500. I mean, I know not having a job, may not have the means, but you can draw on them like a paper.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess the advantage, you could save it and send it, and hopefully they Venmo you the money and PayPal you. If they commissioned you, and
my computer actually does that, I can actually draw on the screen.
Look at you, fancy man!
But what I usually do is I would, like with the original book, the Teaching an Ostrich to Fly, I drew them out in scale, and then I scanned them and then colored them on the so it. It kind of fused the better of both worlds for me because I still got to enjoy the hand atmosphere of it, of actually putting it in the sketches.
Creative juices flowing, Shay.
Uh-huh.
That's beautiful, man. And so is that how you're spending your days when the kids aren't here?
Yeah, I have I have several game systems over there that are going with a lot of they're not being touched very often. They're all old.
It's old to be playing video games.
I spend a good deal of my time playing YouTube videos while I'm sitting with a pad and trying to come up with that next cartoon idea. I've got several little... I'm working on a new book called Norman Alexander. Just call me Normal.
What?
Normal.
Yeah.
Which is another great way of saying that the whole book will be about starting with a fresh perspective, that you can be anything you want to be as a child, and you can take it in any direction. And it's about this kid that's just plain. He's normal, but he lives in what he believes is a world full of superheroes, because he's got a super dad, a super mom. His sister is sinister.
Okay.
So she's the sinister sister. And then there's the super cop and the super mailman, and there's each one's going to have their own little, you know, frame of who they are. And then he's going to be upset that he's not super when his mother, who's super intelligent, because aren't all mothers.
Oh, I love how your mind works, man.
She says, you can be anything you want to be.
Yeah, you can.
So just choose, and then you become super. And we all need to understand that there's nothing wrong with being normal. There's nothing wrong with being you, no matter what you are or who you are.
That's fantastic, man. Shay, so that service is offered artistically while we're being furloughed is you can do real life and caricatures. What else?
I don't do a whole lot of anything else. Yes. I've tried to do landscapes. I'm better at painting on the landscapes.
Oh, you paint as well.
I sometimes do. I don't enjoy it as much.
Right. What was your medium if you do?
I hate watercolors. So it's basically acrylics. And acrylics and water, because I like to thin out the paint sometimes and start real strong in one area and then lighten it out as I paint around it. But the watercolors infuriate me. They mix together too easily. I know somebody that works with them will go, well, that's because you're not doing it right. And you're right. I don't have the patience.
Right. I get it. I mean, you know, I'm looking around the living room here. You don't have an easel, so I'm guessing that you do it on the table?
I do it on the table.
Man, that's... Cool.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Sometimes I just hold it while I'm doing it. But I don't get the same feeling. It's weird how art and different artists are different in their execution and how they feel about their artwork, but there's something about taking somebody's picture and looking them in the eyes, looking deep into what's essentially their soul, and try to capture that moment in a sketch with this pen, nothing but a pencil, just one shading capability that's just used in different forms to create depth and energy and respect for that person in their situation.
Man, you put a lot of feeling into it. I could see as you're speaking to me that you're really thinking about who this person is as you're drawing.
The same look you get when I'm singing those songs.
Oh my god. Yeah, you put a feeling in there. That's but you're taking a picture and you're drawing that picture. It's a cool thing. And you drew me like one of your French girls. No, you drew me. and it hit me dead to rights, man. I got to lose some weight, bro.
You know, it looked
it looks exactly like me, man. It does. And people were just commenting after comment. I don't know if you read all those comments. They were like, wow, that's amazing. That was great. That was fantastic. Hopefully you got
somebody. I need to go back and look, because I don't know that I caught them all. But I'm, you know, anybody that would like to, I mean, hit me up on Shannon Sketches and Illustration. Somebody put Shannon's, no, just Shannon Sketches, like I sketch.
Yes.
and illustrations.
And that's on Facebook?
And that's on Facebook. And I'm not making a business out of it just yet.
You better. I mean,
but if it looks like it could become something, yeah. It's something I would love to dedicate more of my time to. Especially now that I have the time to do it.
Yeah, side hustle becomes and your main hustle.
I know people aren't going to have a whole lot of money right now.
Uh-huh.
And I'm not expecting, you know, hundreds and hundreds of dollars to fall in my lap. But, I mean, if somebody has an advertisement idea,
sure,
I'm more than happy to come up with a cartoon or a sketch or something. And, I mean, anything will help.
Yeah.
Right now.
Is that how you want people to get a hold of you, on the Shannon Sketches?
Uh-huh. They can catch me through that, through the messenger.
Very cool. Well, I'll make sure I'll put that link up in the show notes so people can find it.
I appreciate it.
Any other avenues you want to explore, or you think we got it?
No, I think this is who I am.
Right now. How you got to where you are right now. Mm-hmm. And usually I finish these things off with last words for the people. So I give Shannon, Bray, Shay, Balani the last words for the people. It could be something you words to live by or something that you think of right now. It just pops into your head. Shannon, last words for the people.
I'm deeply involved with this one statement that I've said most of my life. It is what it is. And right now we live in a time where it is what it is. And we don't need to let the historical moment change the impact of who we are and our importance and our beauty. And everybody in this world has an importance. Everybody has a piece to play. And following up with some of this writing that I've been doing, everybody is their own hero to a certain degree to somebody else. You may not be special in your own eyes, but don't take yourself for granted, because you're always going to be a hero to somebody if all you do is just do the right thing and take care of the people around you.
Well, there you have it, party people. Shannon Bray Shay Balani. A little bit more about him. Look at that. Everyone has a story. That man had a story. Been through ups and downs. Interesting life, that man. And now he wants to draw your picture. Yeah, he's got those skills. A musical background and art background, and he went to the art avenue, and now he can draw you like real life, not just caricature, although he does caricatures and cartoons and that kind of thing, but real life images can be captured, the creative hand of Shannon Bray Shay Balani. Thank you so much for being on the program. What makes you famous? I see nothing but great things for you, man. I hope that this art takes off. I appreciate the drawing that you did for me. Thank you so much for getting that to me. I appreciate it. I'm going to put it in a place of honor as soon as I get a frame for it. All right. Shannon Bray Shay Balani. I like it. If you'd like to tell your story, yes, you, the loyal listener, I encourage you to give me a call at 501-470-6386 or email info@radiowhat.com. That's it for me. It's Keys Dan, radiowhat.com, djlittlerock.com. Peace. I'm out of here. If you like what you hear, follow What Makes You Famous social media. Use the hashtag What Makes You Famous. Follow on Facebook at What Makes You Famous. Follow on Instagram at What Makes You Famous. Follow on Twitter at Makes Famous. And follow on YouTube at Keys Dan. Leave What Makes You Famous podcast a review and subscribe. Listen to What Makes You Famous podcast on Podbean, iTunes, YouTube, Stitcher, Google Podcasts, and Spotify, and almost anywhere you find podcasts. Tell your story on my podcast, What Makes You Famous. Call 501-470-6386 and leave a message to set up a time. You can support What Makes You Famous using the PayPal link, paypal.me/KeysDan. Email info@radiowhat.com. What Makes You Famous podcast is a production of Keys Dan Enterprises Incorporated at keysdan.com. Thank you for listening.
Radio What, the music you want, with some great quotes.
Invention is the mother of necessity. Thorsten Veblen.
The music you want, radiowhat.com.
Tweet, tweet, yo. Follow Radio What on Twitter, @RadioWhatTwit. Tweet, tweet, yo.